This morning in the Holy Gospel, we hear the voice of our Lord speaking to us in a very unique way, and that he speaks to a young man who was not diagnosed officially, but was a man who was an epileptic. And epilepsy, as we know, is a severe neurological disease. It is something that, I don't know the statistics specifically, but I know that many people do suffer. It is a medical condition that requires, in most cases, if not in all cases, that the individual be on medication for a good duration or for almost all their lives. In antiquity, epilepsy, because it was not diagnosed as a medical condition, was thought to have been a form of demonic possession. Now, the gospel tells us that the young man who approached Jesus says was an epileptic. But the conditions around which this young man suffered were unique, and that we have the father of the young man coming to Christ and asks him, "Lord, have mercy on my son." And Jesus looks at the young man and sees him thrashing about. And the father asks, "How long has he had this condition?" And he says, "Theotokou, since he was a child." And the father then goes on to say that this condition that he has forces him, against his own control, to throw himself into the water, to drown, or into the fire, to burn himself to death. And then the man says to Jesus, "I approached his disciples," insinuating that he didn't want to disturb Christ because he was always busy and doing so much. And he figured that with his disciples, who were pretty visible around him, he had that entourage of people, the disciples, the 12 apostles, they said they couldn't help us. They didn't know what to do. And Jesus sighs and he says, "O faithless and perverse generation," which is a pretty harsh kind of characterization. "How long," he says, "am I to be with you? How long am I to endure with you?" He says, "Bring him here to me." Now, what's very interesting in this is that people think, well, Jesus must use some kind of words, or because he's God, he has the power to effect this miracle. But it seems that Jesus, in his response, in his sighing, he says, "I should not need to do this. My disciples should have the power to do this." How did the man approach the disciples? The same way the fathers tell us that he approached Jesus. He asked Jesus, point blank, "Have mercy on my son." That is how he approached the disciples. He may have gone up to Peter and said, "Peter, have mercy on my son. James, have mercy on my son. Thomas, have mercy on my son." Now, we think the word mercy means, if we're in a position of authority, that we show clemency or leniency towards another individual. But this is not what the word mercy means in ancient Greek. Eleos is the Greek word. Eleison is the verb. Have mercy. Eleos means to be in a position himself was helpless. The father was helpless. The doctors were helpless. The community was helpless. The synagogue was helpless. The high priests were helpless. No one could do anything, and yet Jesus calls all of them in one bunch. A faithless and perverse generation. The question then comes, naturally, what makes someone faithless and perverse? And the answer, as we're analyzing this, comes to the word mercy. A person who shows love. Love that is feeling the other person's pain, making that person's pain their own. That is love. That is eleos. That is compassion. Suffering with that person. The disciples, the men came up to them and said, "We don't know what to do. Talk to the master." And then the man eventually went to Jesus. "We don't know what to do." Jesus said, however, "Yes, you do know what to do. You send the man away to me, but you have the power to help this man. And you can have faith, and you can be strong if you have love, mercy." The man didn't say, "Heal my son." He said, "Have mercy on my son. Show me love." The man was desperate. He felt that God made him have this possession, this demonic possession or this illness. The man needed someone to love him and his family, to love him and his son. He says, "I have no one. God abandoned me. Medyokseo Theos. Yeti. And I'm coming to you because I need not only my son to be healed, I need my own person to be healed." Because in all of this ordeal, he may very well have lost faith even in God. It's very common. He needed to be made whole, not simply the young man, but the father as well. And all he was asking for was compassion, love. And then Jesus says, "You're a faithless generation. Because if you have love, then you have faith. Because if you love another person, you will pray to God, and God will see your love and help the person." The story kind of continues later on when the disciples were with Jesus privately, and they asked him, "Why could we not help this man?" And Jesus responds, "Because of your little faith." He doesn't say because of your lack of faith. The disciples believed, but their belief was anemic. And the reason their faith was anemic was because they still had not learned what prompts Jesus to heal. It's not because that's what God does. It's because God is love. Because God is love, God heals. And those who follow God must also love. As God loves us, feeling our pain, suffering with us, that's what the cross is all about. It's the co-suffering of God with man. And that co-suffering is what renders miracles in life. It's love. We must begin with that basis of compassionate love, feeling mercy for the other person. And Jesus responds, "This kind cannot be," meaning this kind of demon, "cannot be expelled except through fasting and prayer." The disciples were looking for some kind of, in their mind, they were looking for some kind of tactic. What do we do when a person comes up to us and they're possessed? What do we mumble? What are the words? And Jesus kind of meets them halfway and he says, "You must fast and you must pray." But even here, Jesus doesn't give in to the disciples. last day. Why are we fasting? Because the church tells us to. Not a good reason. Out of obedience, yes, perhaps. But the real reason the church asks us to fast is for us to love God more than ourselves, so that we can show Christ our true love by being obedient to Him. That is why we fast. And so if we truly love God, we fast. If we truly love God, we pray. Why do we pray? Well, because we have different needs. And because that's what Christians do. That's not enough. Why do we pray? Why do we want to spend time with God? Why do we come to church on Sunday? Because it's what we do on Sunday. Horrible reason. Not a good reason. We come to church because we have someone we want to love and be loved by. And that's Him. And that is why we fast. And that is why we pray. And so Jesus is telling the disciples very plainly, you must fast and pray. But when you do, you must have love. That is your motivation. And that should be our motivation for anything we do as Christians. Whether we serve in the parish council, whether we teach as Sunday school teachers, or Greek school, or involve our children in boy, and I know our community is very active in all of these departments. Anything we do must be motivated by love, because where there is love, there is God. And where there is love, where there is God, that is where prokopi happens, progress. There is a, I shared this story with you before, from the lives of the fathers. I forget the name of the elder who said one day, he said, every morning when God looks over the world, He blesses the world with His right hand. But where He sees humility and love in a given area, He blesses that part of the world with both hands. Because God wants us to give Him, God, to each other. That is all that Jesus wanted for the disciples. Jesus would have been proud if the disciples, out of love and compassion, welcomed the man and helped him and prayed, and possibly would have performed the miracle without needing to come to Jesus Himself. But they didn't know how to love Him. And so they passed the buck, talked to the master. And Jesus says, I'll do it, but bring him here to me, because He's not going to let the man walk away. Of course He's going to help him. So the man is healed, but the disciples were not. And Jesus says to them, you must love. And even when you fast, to exorcise a demon. Even when you pray to exorcise a demon, where is your love for that person who is suffering? If it's not there, it's not going to work, because God will not bless it unless there is love, genuine love, not an emotion, an action in which we feel the pain of the other person and make their pain our own. This applies to us, brothers and sisters, very, very clearly. Because in our lives, how many times have we chosen to show love to each other and we see it and the love is genuine? And how many times have we seen God's hand working and blessing us and allowing miracles to happen? I can't begin to tell you the miracles that I've seen in my life. And I know you will agree, even in your own lives, you've seen how these miracles play out. But if we have no love, and we simply close doors in people's faces, these people will suffer, but so will we. Because we were given an opportunity to be conduits, ambassadors of God's grace, and we chose not to. That is not what the Christian is, only in name. The Christian is someone who lives and breathes God, and since he lives and breathes God, he has enough of God inside of him to share God with others. That is our calling. That is what we were brought into this. this world to do. And don't think that you don't have that ability. You don't have that power. There's nothing mystical or unique or magical about giving God to people. We already have God inside of us. I wrote yesterday on Facebook, I was thinking in my philosophizing, theologizing, I was thinking to myself, it is true that, you know, we all have God, but we close our eyes and we think he's not there, but he's there. And every moment, every time that we spend time with another person to help them, to listen to them, to do small acts of kindness, be they deliberate or random or however they may come, we give the people Christ. We may think that we don't, but we do because we give people love. Where there is love, there is Christ. And if we can give Christ to each other, then we are doing God's will, and then miracles will happen. Miracles happen because, not because God wills them, but because we will them together with God's will. That's how miracles happen. So I wanted to share with you these several thoughts this morning, brothers and sisters. Please remember that we have, in our faith, a great, great weapon against evil. We also have a great, great tool for bringing souls to God. All of us have that grace. We receive it in baptism. The struggle of life is to have that grace visible so that we can use it when called upon. And the truth is, we are called to use this gift daily in our lives. So let us give Christ to one another. In conclusion, I have talked about this before. You look at the icon of La Titera, which we've had so beautifully repaired in our church. It's a beautiful icon. It is the icon of the giving of God to us. The Theotokou, who had Christ in her womb for 9 months, says to us, to the world, because we then says to Paradiso, I give him to you, not because she doesn't want him, right? He was mine, he is mine, and I give him to you. It's the icon, the primary icon of giving God to each other. Why did the Theotokos deign to give birth to Christ? Because she was told to? No, she wasn't forced to do anything. God waited for her response, and she said yes. Why did she say yes? Because she says, behold the handmaiden of the Lord, let it be done to me as you will. Why did she say this? Because of her burning love for God. If she didn't love God, she would have said, no, I don't think so, Fulana, I don't think I can do this. But love dispels all darkness and all fear. That is why we must show love. Just like that. That's beautiful. So, let's put it out of your glasses. May God bless you.